En dan nu wil ik graag aankondigen met trots en met heel veel genoegen onze keynote-spreker Olivier de Schutter. Keynote-introductie is in het Engels, dus ik schakel nu voor de aankondiging ook even over naar het Engels. Olivier de Schutter is professor at the University of Leuven in Belgium. And he is also special rapporteur of the United Nations on extreme poverty and human rights. But today, he will do this introduction in his role as co-chair of the International Panel of Experts on Sustainable Food Systems, IPES Food. Please, Olivier, à vous.
Many thanks indeed, and very delighted to contribute to this important discussion on this research project that is being launched. Let me try to say in a few words why this moment is unique and should be seized by the research community to contribute to the search for sustainable food systems, and what are the conditions for a successful transition to sustainable food systems to take place. I would like to perhaps share with you some slides in order to make perhaps more clear what I would like to say in the few minutes I have. So first of all, I would like to note that the crisis we are facing is actually not one, but three crises. We have developed since the 1950s an approach towards food systems and agri-food policies that tries to emphasize the growth of production, the increase of yields per hectare, in an approach that provides low wages and low farm gate prices to producers, but compensated by the subsidies they are provided. It's an approach that rewards economies of scale and the large mechanized monocultures that dominate our agricultural landscapes, and it provides subsidized access to fossil energy to drive the productionist machine. So we've developed a low-cost food economy that actually tries to boost production in order to keep prices low for consumers. But of course, what consumers do not pay is paid by taxpayers, by future generations, because of the very significant impacts that these food systems have on various dimensions of sustainability. And I would like to highlight in particular three impacts that result from the productivist approach we've been following over the past 40 or 60 years. The first impacts are environmental. It is not by accident that when scientists try to work on the planetary boundaries, in other terms, the dimensions of ecosystems that are at threat as a result of human activity, they focus on a number of barriers that food systems are contributing to exceed. For example, they focus on the loss of genetic diversity, the loss of biodiversity. They focus on the nitrogen cycle and on the phosphorus cycle. They focus on climate change. And all these planetary boundaries, as they are called in the scientific literature, illustrated by this scheme you have here, are deeply linked to how food systems have developed. For example, the food systems are responsible for about one third of greenhouse gas emissions, for the most important proportion of the loss of biodiversity, and for the depletion of soil health, resulting in soils being much less able to function as carbon sinks. On the left, you have pictures of soils that are heavily degraded as a result of monoculture developing. They are subject to erosion, to compaction as a result of large machinery being used, to salinization. And on the right of the slide, you have the agroecological alternative, the use on a same piece of land of different types of plants, trees, sometimes animals. Combining these different elements allows you to maintain a certain diversity and thus to preserve the biological life of the soil and to allow the soil to function much better as a carbon sink, as a reservoir of agrobiodiversity, and to have a strong biological life, allowing the soil to better metabolize the compost that it receives. So that is the first set of impacts, the environmental impacts. The second impacts are social. We have in all Europe many small farms that are disappearing because they are less competitive in the markets as they have developed. They're unable to face competition from large-scale mechanized farms practicing monocultures. And as a result, we have over the past 20 or 30 years in countries such as Belgium and France, about two-thirds of the farms that have disappeared. And then thirdly, there are public health impacts to the low-cost food economy that we have developed. Look, for example, at these two maps. This is a map from 1975, showing how in different world regions, the bodily mass index of the population has been rated. And 40 years later, in the year 2014, the bodily mass index measurement leads to a very different picture, with all world regions witnessing a significant increase of people with overweight or obesity. And of course, you might say, well, in a period of 40 years between 1975 and 2015, it's normal that, you know, population are more overweight and more obese because the people live longer. So we have more people who are older, but these maps are corrected for that feature. So they take into account the net increase of the bodily mass index in the average adult population. And this shows how in all world regions, the shift to processed diets, to foods that are less healthy and diverse, lead to this epidemics of overweight and obesity. Now, these are the impacts. We cannot ignore these impacts anymore. And many people today are thinking about how to change the system. The difficulty is that we have a number of components of food systems that have co-evolved and that have become very difficult to change as a result. The food system, if you wish, is very resistant to change because the technologies, the economics, the consumption habits, the culture, and the political choices have co-evolved over the years and have become mutually supportive. In sum, we've developed technologies that support large-scale monocultures. The current food system is dominated by economic actors that have a very strong competitive advantage on other emerging actors. We have developed lifestyles and consumption habits, eating habits that are very difficult to displace and that reward bigness and uniformity and increased reliance on processed foods and convenience foods. And we have a political system that must accept that in order to maintain the prices of food low, you must give ever more freedom to operate to the large economic actors that dominate the current landscape. So how to change this? How to unlock this system? Well, this is what the current food strategies that are being developed try to achieve. In May 2020, 1 year ago, the European Commission announced as part of the Green Deal, a new farm-to-fork strategy for fair, healthy, and environmentally friendly food systems. And it now is thinking about developing a legislative framework to support this farm-to-fork strategy. And this farm-to-fork strategy is the result of a very impressive mobilization of civil society in the years 2016, 2019, demanding a food policy for the EU. And in this large campaign across Europe, our requests were at three levels. And these were the three priorities we saw for a successful transition to sustainable food systems. First, we insisted on the need for cross-sectorial coherence. We must have much more coherence and much better synergies between agriculture, environment, health, employment, trade, investment, in other terms, between all the sectorial policies that determine the shape of food systems that, but until now, have been disconnected from one another. And the clearest example is that of trade. We have many attempts across Europe to rebuild local sustainable food systems at regional or even municipal levels. The city of Ede-Wageningen is a good example in the Netherlands. But these policies are not supported by the trade policies of the EU, that instead impose on producers to be competitive on world markets and drive agri-food policies with an obsession for export competitiveness. So cross-sectoral coherence is the first objective. The second objective is a governance for transition. We need to have indicators of progress, to have a monitoring of progress, to move from one system to another. This should go beyond simply managing the system as it is. Thirdly and finally, we need food democracy. Very clearly, agri-food policies until now have been set behind closed doors with little transparency and accountability. And as a result, the policymakers that are on the right hand of this scheme here, they are fed with narratives about what needs to be done. And the dominant narrative is we need to increase production to feed the world. This explains why they invest in input responsive crops and specialized livestock breeds to boost production, why they support big farms rather than small scale farmers, why alternatives cannot really emerge if we remain focused on the objective of increasing global calorie production. And of course, small farmers in this context are forced either to become larger, to have more land at their disposal, or to disappear. And the big food processors, traders, retailers, and agrochemicals companies, they of course find it much more convenient to feed this narrative about what needs to be done to policymakers. And finally, this is why we need food democracy. The farm to fork strategy developed by the European Commission today is really the result of a democratic exercise in reclaiming control over food systems. And we, for example, organized in 2018, a European-wide food and farming forum at which a number of alternatives were discussed with some 200 organizations across Europe to reinvent our food systems. I firmly believe that beyond the governance of transition, beyond the need for much more coherence across sectoral policies, we need to democratize the food systems to make the decisions much more accountable to people and much more transparently adopted. I wish you all the best in this very important research project, which I look forward to following, and I'm sure it will help very much at European and international level to provide support to this revolution in food systems that is ongoing. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Olivier. It is great to learn from your vast international experience about the three conditions for a successful transition, because we sure need this. And also, thank you very much for the groundbreaking work of IPES Food. Really much appreciated. And we also look forward, as a coalition, to share our insights and results in due course to your panel of experts on food systems. So once again, thank you very much for your great contribution. Let's keep in touch.